It's the blood of the not comment. So would you go ahead and help us out a little bit? Comment, hit like, and make a comment. Preach with us. We like that. Hallelujah. And nobody's going to bite you around here. We don't bite. And we don't even bite those who bite us. Right? Most of us don't. Hallelujah. Oh, that worship is good. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Rain in Texas. Oh, Lord, may it just sweep all across Texas.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Okay, Romans 14. Happy is the man who does not condemn himself, is the name of the message. Then I made a comment, be blessed with a happy conscience. That's your blessing, is that everybody who is a born-again Christian should have a happy conscience. Because all shame has been taken away. Our sins are as far as the east is from the west. God has forgotten them. So why should we go around with dragging our old past with us? Amen?
Amen.
And I have spent my life trying to please the Lord, but I can tell you I've done some dumb and stupid things along the path. And probably I'll do some more before I get to heaven. I hope not, Lord, but when we need to, sometimes it just, he knows what it takes to keep us humble. So, last week, our promise was to put on Christ, put on the armor of light, and we were still preaching that on Sunday morning. It was so strong and powerful, and the music was even coming forth, and all week, it was just a message of, because for one reason, Jim Sheets, at his Sunday service a week ago, the Lord gave him a vision that the Lord had released angels of light over all 50 states, and they shot up like a firecracker into the heavens and released all of God's promises and prophecies and fulfillment over us. And you know, I guess Sunday night I received promises of prophecies that I had received 30 years ago. Think about it. And I'm sure it's Brother Stephen George did that. I'm simply certain of these. You know, for the last 2 years he's been in Scandinavia, and last time he was at our church, he was needed to go into the Arab countries. And that was at the house on Sunday evening, I think. And he could, when, do you remember when that was, Sandy? You were there, I'm sure. Yeah, and he was leaving then to go to the Arab countries. He spent a couple of years amongst them. So God sure uses him where I can't be using our shape while he was covered with power. And he was leaving already gone, I guess, tomorrow, go back to Norway. And, okay, we'll be fine. We'll just open up the blind. Hallelujah. And he's and be gone until the end of the I think end of November. We're coming back to Thanksgiving. Yeah. So I started asking what the weather was like there, but I forget, and I thought, oh well, maybe it's, I don't know if it's summer or winter there, but it's springtime. It's winter there. Okay, so they're going in to meet snow and everything. Okay. All right, chapter 14. Righteousness and the kingdom of God are inseparable. In my notes from, I think it was 2018, the last time I taught this whole book. And I have notes from 2010, but I'm pretty sure it was 2018. The Lord spoke to me about the book of Romans, but he told me. Preaching, and I had made a note of it in that in this particular chapter that I was to teach the book of Romans and that I was totally opposite. Kingdom righteousness has its roots in the king's heart. It is not based on legal standing, nor does it its justice approximate man's concepts about justice or judgment. And I have to watch that all the time, that I don't put my concepts of justice and judgment on Christ's people. Its judgments reach beyond the simple reasoning of courts and legislation, for it is based on imitation of King Jesus. Romans 14:17. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Paul lays out the righteousness of Jesus Christ in comparison to the righteousness of the law. We are to emulate Christ's inner being, his ways, his methods, his desire to redeem mankind and grant mercy. And this is the heart that God wants for us, that we don't put judgments on people, but that we seek to redeem them and to grant them mercy. That's a hard human thing to do sometimes. This is kingdom righteousness. And when it is practiced by his children, it is not defined as filthy rags. It is a rich garment to be worn for Christ's glory. Pharisees judge all things according to man's righteousness and have no comprehension of kingdom principles. Kingdom righteousness is more than faithful execution of social order or spiritual tenets. Or without any entering the very nature of God, no righteousness exists. All of our righteousness is as filthy rags. In the kingdom, the king rewards those who align with his heart and purpose. And as we allow the word and the spirit to work the graces of this chapter into our heart, we are then putting on Christ and living in the realm of the Holy Spirit. And I would recommend to everyone that every time you're having a relationship problem, that you go read Romans 14 and allow God to work this word into you, and which is what we have with his grace. The grace of his word is to be worked into us. For we just can't say, da 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 da. No, we become it. Jesus' parable, the rich man and Lazarus, is applied to the gulf that was fixed between them. It's like the spiritual gulf that separated the rich man's unrighteousness from Lazarus' kingdom righteousness. Kingdom righteousness finds definition from the branch of righteousness, the one so designated to be the order of who is king of righteousness and peace. His ministry was and is the ministry of righteousness. 2 Corinthians 3:9. For if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. Glory rests upon the ministry of righteousness, for out of it flows all ministries. There is no true ministry apart from the ministry of righteousness, peace, and joy. If you're not operating in those three things, in ministry to people, you're not operating in the kingdom. Every action of God issues from it, and every believer has a ministry of righteousness, or he or she is not a believer. Romans 14:22. Do you have faith? Have it to yourself before God. Happy is he that condemns not himself in that which he allows. One of the keys to happiness. And happiness will always be found inside ourselves. You cannot look to your mate, you cannot look to your children, You cannot look even to the Christian church and family for your happiness. You will only find it inside yourself with Jesus Christ. So now let's go to Romans 1, 1 through 3. As for the brother who is weak in faith, make him feel at home in your fellowship, and don't argue with him about his scruples.
Yeah.
Word of God. People on Facebook, don't argue with those people about their scruples.
Amen.
If you can't say, thus saith the Lord to them, keep your mouth shut. That's what Jesus did. Still reading Romans 1 through 3. You are not called to straighten out his conscience. One man, for example, has the faith to eat anything, while the weaker man eats vegetables only. So much for you vegetarians, she's saying. The man with the freedom to eat meat should not despise the man that is not that free. Vegetarian, on the other hand, must not judge the meat eater, for God has accepted him.
Thank you, Lord.
Salvation is not in view here. Paul is comparing Christians, the strong in faith with the weak in faith. The apostle is instructing them or us concerning their attitude toward each other. Not all believers have the same knowledge of the things of Christ, or the same faith to appropriate liberty in the Lord. If you're a pastor, you know that, and you accept every person where they are, and as a minister of Christ, you minister to that person where they are. And as a prophet, you might speak into their life where God wants them to go. Because you will see God's plan for their destiny in life. And so you speak into them where God wants to take them to. Amen?
Amen.
Brother Stephen George Sunday night told me where God wanted me to do. Praise the Lord. I'm going to get it done. I mean, with God's help, I will get before him and ask him, what is this path forward? Because it was not a new word to me, it was a confirmation of words through years. In every fellowship, there are those whose consciences will not allow them to do this or that. Okay? And you just be real happy with whatever it is that God has told you not to do, you best not do it. God told me not to put my tongue on my pants. I have been working very hard on that, but you all do whatever you feel led to do. It's not my problem. I'm not your policeman.
Amen.
I got to worry about my own tongue. They have scruples. Then there are those who understand that Christ has set them free from customs and traditions, and they enjoy wide liberty in the Lord. Their consciences allow them to do anything they can do as unto the Lord. Such a Christian the apostle regards as strong in faith. And because of the big difference between these two types of Christians, the apostle feels it's important to counsel how to treat the other. Still is. In the first verse, his instructions are aimed at the stronger Christian. He is to open his heart to the weaker Christian, admitting him to the fellowship with no thought of straightening out his scruples. In the early days of the church, the matter of eating meat was touchy. Big deal. Consequently, it provided Paul with a good illustration of what he means by the weaker Christians. A considerable amount of meat sold in the marketplace had been slaughtered on pagan altars and offered in heathen sacrifices. Therefore, where some Gentile converts refused to eat it. They felt it involved them with the idols. I might have a little trouble with that myself. Okay, but Paul's, no, yeah, okay, moving on here. Only those with strong faith in Jesus' words had the liberty to eat it. Some of the converts from Judaism had similar scruples about eating meat that were declared unclean in the Old Testament. To them, it was outright disobedience to do so. They feared it would injure their fellowship with the Lord. This was their faith until they came to the place where they understood their former customs and traditions were done away in Christ. To a Jew, you become a Jew. To a Gentile, you become a Gentile. Wherever I go to minister, I discern where that group of people are, and I minister to them where they are. But I minister Jesus. Jesus declared all food clean, Mark 7:18-19. He said to them, "Are you so without understanding also? Do you not perceive that whatsoever thing from outside enters into the man, it cannot defile him? Because it enters not into his heart, but into the belly, and goes out into the draught, purging all meats." And he said, "That which comes out of the man, that defiles the man. For from inside, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornication, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, and foolishness. All these evil things come from the inside and defile the man." There are many things a Christian encounters in the course of a day for which we are he has opened his conscience to guide him. The Bible does not tell us everything we can or cannot do. Such matters are as going to movies or certain movies, the length of skirts, the length of your hair, our taste in clothing. Of course, years ago, all these things were relevant and taught from the pulpit that you had to wear your hair a certain way, you had to dress a certain way, and all these things. Well, I don't know, I guess that's still in some cultures, but we don't deal with that. But these things are not covered in the Bible. You can't, if you're dressed decently, with no exposure of anything, pastor can't tell you how to dress, can't tell you what car to drive, how to wear your hair. That's not part of ministry. We had a lot of that going on years ago. So the rule is this. If you were super spiritual, you dressed a certain way. I'm not going back to them. So now I'm going to. The rule is this. When the Word of God is silent on a matter, the conscience becomes the voice of God to the soul and acts in full authority of God. If a man goes against his conscience, he's rebelling against the rule of God over his life. So if I get a check, and I get checked, I mean, I can just think something, I get checked. I don't know about other people out there, but in Paul's illustration, the weaker brother is the one who is a vegetarian by conscience. He is not referring to the man who abstains from meat for health reasons. This is another matter. He's thinking of the man who believes that eating meat would cause God to be displeased with him. When a Christian thinks he's more spiritual because of scruples, he is prone to condemn the brother who walks in liberty. Paul labels him the weaker Christian. He has yet to see that every creature of God is good and nothing is to be rejected. 1 Timothy 4:4. The man with liberty is not to despise the man with scruples. A lot of our scruples are really OCD. We just want it done exactly our way. The weaker Christian is not to judge his stronger brother. This is not to give license to unscrupulous living, but being able to enjoy many things as unto the Lord, which the weaker brother will not allow himself. Romans 14:4. Besides, what right have you to criticize someone else's servant, especially when that someone else is God? It is not up to you to say whether a man stands or falls. That's up to his master. In this case, the man will stand because his master has the power to make him stand. Paul says you have no right to make a judgment against a servant of the Lord. Every Christian is the Lord's servant. Only Jesus has the right to judge anyone. Then Paul adds this fascinating word, yea, he shall be helped up. For God is able to make him stand. If a person's master is satisfied with him, what does it matter if others are not? It is not only pointless for a weaker brother to pass judgment, but also dangerous to do so. In this verse, it appears the Lord is speaking that the stronger brother is guaranteed not to fall in the use of his liberty. The weaker brother has no such guarantee. He is not promised any support to stand in his scruples. He could fall, and this verse, in effect, is a warning. We see further that the stronger brother is responsible only to the Lord for his actions. When a church begins to make rules affecting what believers eat or drink, or any moral trivia, that church is out of line. These matters are settled between the Lord and the individual Christians. 5-6. Yes, Lord, y'all get a witness? I just did. I stay out of a lot of stuff. I just don't get into it. People get themselves rolled into a bunch of stuff that they don't have to be rolled up in. One man feels certain days should be set aside for special worship of God, while another man doesn't see any difference between the days to him. Every day belongs to the Lord. When it comes to such things as these, let each Christian make up his own mind and set it between the Lord and himself. That way, those who feel the day itself is holy will keep it as unto the Lord, and those who feel they can eat anything will eat unto the Lord, for they thank God for the food. The same is true of the person who abstains from meat. He too is concerned for Jesus' lordship, inasmuch as he also gives thanks that he can forego certain foods for the Lord's sake. Sandra told me this morning she was fasting her television because it broke. I told her, I said, I bet you ran a crowd for that, Sandra. Hallelujah. Okay. The question was raised at Rome, and these write the Romans. As when you're not Christian, you should keep the holy days of the Jews. Those days were spelled out in the Old Testament. That was the only Bible they had. Paul is writing the epistles of the New Testament. They're being walked out. Most serious was the matter of the weekly Sabbath. The seventh day. of you. The practice of keeping that Sabbath, Saturday, was in direct conflict with keeping Lord's Day, the first day of the week, Sunday. Lord Jesus, the anointing is so strong, Jesus. This had become the practice in the churches to commemorate the Lord's resurrection. Acts 20, verse 7. On the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached to them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. Paul himself had directed offerings to be gathered on the first day of the week. Now some weaker ones said, we must keep the Jewish Sabbath. Others said it was ridiculous to invest any day with special sacredness because every day belonged to the Lord. Jubilee. Every year belongs to the Lord since Jesus' resurrection. Now, there is a 50-year blessing because I got one on my 50th year. I'm sorry I won't be hanging around for the next 50th year.
Yeah,
that was a really good year for me with my 50th year. I'm telling you, I had so many blessings that year. That was the year I actually started the church. I did everything. I had a visit, boom. Visitation, everything broke out in my life on my 50th year. Yeah. Moving on here. We're going to end of these days here. Okay. Paul said, let each Christian make up his own mind about it. That means we don't have to straighten anyone out about the feast or anything. Are going to church on Saturday or going to church on Sunday, or we just don't have to straighten them out. Now, I hear this argument. I said earlier in here from time to time now among Christians, but it's getting stronger all the time, of Christians arguing over days. The principle of observing one day and seven as holy unto the Lord still holds. I made up my mind personally. Sunday is the day I choose for special worship and gathering with saints. Yet I have entered the Sabbath rest of the Lord. And true, all days are holy unto Him. That's where I am, just in case y'all, somebody asked that question. Those in Christ are removed from the legal and external requirements of the law. We have settled that through Romans. Don't let anybody put it on them. Now, if they're under it, you bless them and keep going because Paul is vindicating them here. They are guided by another principle, the leading of the Holy Spirit. This is opposite of the position of some institutional churches which give all authority to the church under the institution. Read that again, because I started talking in the middle of it. Those in Christ are removed from the legal and external requirements of the law. They are guided by another principle, the leading of the Holy Spirit. And this is opposite of the position of some institutional churches which give all authority to the church. There are churches still today. I saw one church here maybe something about the man church. There are churches today who think the pastor has more authority over the home than the husband. That's not true. That's a lie from the pit of hell. God made the family before He made the church. And the family has more authority in the home than the church. Paul says for the individual to decide when it comes to eating meat and keeping days. Those are minor matters. We should never get into a debate over it. Such questions as can I do this? Can I go here or there? How should a believer act in this situation? because believers make up their own minds about such things. Why? So they will mature. The only way he can get us to grow up and be like him, which is the whole plan of salvation, is to put on our own, is to put us on our own for such things. That's why I operate and I do this. Not in any way. I do this with my children. I do this out of love. If I see people going the wrong way and they're not listening to what the Word of God says, I give them all the rope they want. Okay? Because the rope's going to hang them. The rope will hang them. But it will be their rope that hangs them, but God's going to catch them. But he's allowing it for them to grow. Yeah. I was standing, I was talking on the way here, and sometimes the only way we will get delivered is that we will face our own demons in someone else. Yeah. And then we will get delivered. And God will allow that too. So, all right. Hallelujah. Gotta move on here, Lord. That's why we're guided by principles rather than rules. That's why he leads us so, leads so many things to our conscience. It, now, you may have a very... I may be stepping on your toes today because there may be some things that you're not willing to depend on. Okay, I don't care. Okay, go do it. I'm free of adding to belief anyone. Any parent, teacher, leader, or pastor who tells someone every little thing to do will stunt the growth of the person they're responsible for. The Lord has provided us with everything we need for an enlightened conscience. The Word, the Holy Spirit, and the example of Jesus. He places us in the valley of decision, free to follow our conscience. And if you don't get peace, I think you stop right there. If you push beyond your peace, I say you're in trouble. You have walked outside the realm of the Holy Spirit. If people have faith to appropriate their freedom in Christ, they will be free to do many things. Without that faith, the believer will regard the Bible as a rule book rather than a revelation of God's person and try to emulate him of our own free will. Christian liberty is limited to pleasing the Lord. We are not to please ourselves. However, no two Christians set about to please the Lord in the same way. The apostle illustrated this by saying, if one brother can eat meat as unto the Lord, that's his privilege. If another brother cannot, that's his privilege. As long as it is his aim of each to please the Lord. 7-9. The fact is, neither one of us lives as his own master, and neither one of us dies as his own master. While we're alive, we live as the Lord's servants, and when we die as the Lord's servants. That's why Jesus died and returned to life again, so that he could be the Lord of both the dead and the living. Word of God. As Christians, we don't embrace a cut-and-dry faith that fits us into an act-alike, think-alike, dress-alike, eat-alike, live-alike model. We are free to think for ourselves and approach God any way we like. We can be what we want to be before the Lord, and we don't have to copy anyone else.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, we learn from verse 7 that our individualism is to be regulated by the Lordship of Christ. We are not the masters of our own lives. We cannot arrogantly say, it is my life. I did it my way. Fact is, the Lord bought us with his own blood, and we are his. He is the master now, not us. It is the clearly defined will of God that we should be conformed to the image of his Son. And we are obliged to follow the example of our master. Our service to Jesus doesn't stop when we die. It continues into the realm of heaven. How did Jesus acquire this absolute lordship? He died to purchase, redeem us. On that basis, he has the right to demand whatever he pleases from us. He is Lord on both sides of the grave. By his resurrection, he proved that there's no such thing as death to the soul, which has been born again of the Spirit. We become, the soul becomes spirit as we become more like Jesus. The Spirit controls the soul. The soul doesn't rule us. Jesus' resurrection guarantees his rule over us throughout eternity. If Jesus is absolute Lord over our lives, who would he have the right to tell us how to live? So if a weak brother or a strong brother insists that their way of living is the rule for all the rest of us, he trespasses the Lordship of Jesus. He or she is assuming a privilege that belongs to Jesus alone. Either the one with liberty or the one of the law transgresses into a religious spirit if they judge and impose their beliefs on one another. 10 through 12. You there, why do you judge your brother? And you over there, why do you despise your brother? One day, every single one of us will personally stand before the judgment seat of God. Then will be fulfilled what we read in Scripture. As I live, says the Lord, everybody will kneel before me and everybody will confess that I am God. So you see, each one of us must give an account of himself to God. He is the one to whom we must all answer. In that day when we stand before the Lord, your opinion of me won't make any difference. And neither will my opinion of you. Or anyone else's. All that will matter is what Jesus thinks of us. At this judgment, the secrets of men's hearts will be laid bare. It will be seen that only the Lord Jesus can render a proper judgment. Interesting, we've got the trial of, civil trial of Donald Trump, and he got a break yesterday. Amen. And the trial of Hunter Biden going on at the same time. And I've been praying that God will spring the traps that are set for Donald Trump, yes, and that God's judgment and justice will be done.
Yes.
Only he knows our motives and the secrets of our hearts. Only that part of us that is one with him will live through his judgment as we go through the fire. Every fire that God has ever brought me through, the only thing that came through was whatever I had left in me that was of Jesus. Don't want anything else. We are forbidden to regard one another with contempt. It is not even to be in our hearts. Contempt is the fruit of pride. There are two thrones of judgment. The judgment seat of Christ for believers, 2 Corinthians 5:10. And the great white throne judgment for unbelievers, Revelation 20, verse 11. A Christian sin, now I've got to move along here. See how we've been there. Oh, I got it. I should make it. A Christian sin is not judged by the judgment seat of Christ. Sin is judged at Calvary. If a man refuses Christ, he is guilty of all sin. James 2:10. Galatians 6:6. would be Jesus. The Father judges no man, but has committed all judgments unto the Son. Romans 14:12. So then every one of us shall give account of himself to God. 1 John 2:28. Now those children abide in him, that when he shall appear, we have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. And I want to assure you, because I have experienced it, he shall, if he doesn't come, he'll call. And there are many times when you will have visitations when he shall appear in this lifetime. But we don't want to be ashamed before him. I've never been able to stand up. 13 through 14. In view of the judgment of God, let's put an end to judging one another. If we must judge, let's judge ourselves and make sure we don't do anything to cause a brother to stumble or fall in his Christian walk. And yet, as I say that, I know and am persuaded by the Lord Jesus himself that there is nothing in all of God's creation that is unclean of itself. Still, if a man still believes something is evil and will damage his fellowship with the Lord, he's right. It will. In view of the coming judgment, says Paul, Christians must stop judging one another for such mortal trivial as food and drink. But there is something Christians should judge, that they don't put the stumbling block in the path of a weaker brother or cause him to fall. If you have if you have something toxic in your car, where you have got off against a brother or a sister of Christ, where your feelings are hurt, don't go to a weaker brother and dump it on them. You're going to cause that Christian to stone. And they'll stay out of church. You go to a stronger Christian and go there for counsel. You don't go to a weaker Christian and empty up your jerk. Because then you have put a stumbling block in front of that Christian where they won't want to be in church. Believers should be stepping stones to maturity rather than hindrances. Troublemakers look for a crack to cause trouble. They will look for your weakest point, like Delilah, to see where they can make you fall or where they can create trouble. Troublemakers enjoy the attention and the drama they get from stirring up trouble. It is a naughty spirit. And there is a naughty spirit. As a pastor, I've had to deal with it multiple times. We don't have it operating in this church right now. Praise God. But I have had to deal with it multiple times. A naughty spirit likes to create a disturbance to get attention. And they'll do it like they're having fun. But it's a naughty spirit. When I wrote this, probably 2010 or 2018, I might have been dealing with the naughty spirit. That's why I got in there. Proverbs 6:12. Anybody know a naughty person? Y'all ever had to deal with the naughty spirit? A naughty person, a wicked man, walks with a froward mouth. This person has fun doing little naughty stuff. They're a trickster. Okay, I have had to deal with that one thing my lifetime. And my mother had a naughty spirit. She did not learn how to deal with that from the time I was a child. She did it for fun. Lord, bless my mother in heaven. I don't mean to say anything against her. I just learned, that's where I learned how to deal with that thing. Bless my mother in heaven. A strong Christian may feel the liberty to do many things. must also be guided with what his actions produced in the mind of his weaker brother. Christianity did away with the ceremonial requirements of Judaism. Many people today think it's going to be, they will be more spiritual if they become a Jew and put on the ceremonial tradition of the Jews. No, now the Word of God says that we're going to become one new man, and the Jew and the Christian are going to become Christians after Jesus Christ. Because Jesus fulfilled all the law, temple ordinances, and sacrifices. But if a weaker brother doesn't understand this and thinks a certain thing is unclean, then as far as his conscience is concerned, it is unclean. Let us not be unwise or unloving in the use of our liberty. In doing so, if we are leaders, we can hurt a weaker brother. As Christians, and all of you are leaders, all that we should do, am I going to help this person or am I going to hurt them in what I say and do? Nor does that mean we come under the bondage of the weaker Christian to please them. This is a trap for pastors and leaders. If a weaker Christian puts forth demands, either or I'm going to have a temper tantrum, make a scene, and get everybody upset. And if you give in to that, then that individual is controlling you, the pastor, and the church. Which is what the devil wants. We can cripple weaker Christians if we cause them to stumble. A believer stumbles when the sheer force of his brother's example causes him to do what his conscience tells him is wrong. The apostle then states the truth that nothing is unclean of itself. He says, by knowledge, I know, and I am persuaded. Y'all hear me say all the time, my persuasion is. He says, I am persuaded to walk in Christian liberty requires knowledge and conviction, being persuaded by the Lord. Paul is speaking of ceremonial religious uncleanness and moral uncleanness. The apostle is referring to those neutral matters such as customs and traditions, amusements, what is proper dress, and so forth. Verses 15 through to 16. Therefore, if you know a brother feels that way about something you're eating, and you go ahead and eat it anyway, you are not eating out of love. See, people think this when they read this chapter, it's about eating. Now, Paul's just using this as an example for everything. How can it possibly be right to use your freedom to damage someone for whom Christ died? If you do that, you are taking something that is good as far as you're concerned and making it look like evil to someone else. In this church, women have the liberty to wear pants to minister the gospel, stand behind the pulpit and preach the gospel, as well as minister to both male and female. However, there are those churches that do not operate in that liberty. When I go to one of those churches, I submit to their rules. No matter where I go, to someone else's house, I submit to their rules. Now, I would not go against my conscience, of course not, but whatever rules they have, I come into submission to those rules. Nor do I impose my liberty on their conscience. We are to handle our freedom in such a way that it doesn't become an object of scorn or of division. We are obliged to display tender concern so as not to injure a weaker brother. We are not to flaunt our liberty to injure others. If we do, our liberty becomes a religious spirit, which is not any different than those who are in bondage to the law, traditions, customs, and rules. 17 through 18. After all, the kingdom of God does not consist of eating and drinking, does it? Indeed not. must do with righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Therefore, the man who exalts Christ by putting these things first in his life not only pleases God, but wins the approval of men as well. So let's set our heart on those things which make for peace in the fellowship and strengthen one another in the faith. And this is how you walk in humility. If you're willing to lay down your OCD to make peace. Or what you just really set your head on. If you're willing to lay yours down to make peace, then the person who lays that down to make peace is the one that gets the reward in heaven, not the one who demanded their own way. What Christian really wants to carry on the work of God in a brother over a dish of food? While it's true that everything is pure, anything can become evil when a stronger brother uses it to cause a weaker brother to stumble. Therefore, it is a godly thing to abstain from meat or wine or anything else that would hurt a brother or sister. Do you have the faith to do things which others can't do and still have a happy conscience? That's wonderful. But if you want to continue in that blessedness, make sure your actions do not go beyond your convictions. And don't flaunt your freedom before a brother who doesn't have your convictions. Keep your happy conscience to yourself and God. On the other hand, the man whose conscience questions the rightness of what he is about to do should stop at once. If he proceeds with doubt in his mind, he will condemn himself. He is then acting from a bad conscience and not from faith. Any action not based on faith is sinful.
Good word.
Yes.
That helps me a lot.
See, when people read that chapter, they just read over it real fast and think, oh, this is about eating meat and all that. No, it's not about it. That's what he's using, but that's not what it's about. Because it was an issue when he spoke it. No, this is about how to have a weaker Christian and stronger Christian. Scripture.
church is trying to put on people and make them feel bad about themselves and have to do this, have to do that. I mean, this is a book that has set us free, and your teaching has just brought everything out so clear. Just thank God for this book and your teaching.
Again, thank you, Diana. Thank the Lord. Thank all the people. You see, you have to. You have to become it.
Together, Lord, bind us together. I own. trial is not a jury trial, it's a bench trial. So the judge will make it, which, you know, they are probably finding guilty. So they appeal. So you'll have to win on an appeal more than likely.
I don't know. I think the attorney general is going down.
She needs to.
Going down. In total distress.
She's come up against God's law, and that's what happens when you do that.
Should we pray now?
Can we pray now?
She knows where she needs to be held with you. And I decree that that attorney general in New York is totally going down.
Yes.
In disgrace.
Yes,
so yes, we agree.
It's a political stunt. That's what it's a stunt. Just
yes.
A political stunt.
Vile and evil.
Yes.
I posted it several places. It is not the borrower's responsibility to determine the value of the property. It's the lending institution has the responsibility to determine the value of the property if they make loans on the property. It's not the borrower's responsibility.
And my understanding is that all the contracts that were signed at the end is like a disclaimer saying this is the best assessment given under at this time, blah, 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 blah. I mean, it's just plain as the nose on your face.
They
so,
would have an appraisal in there by a certified appraiser of that property.
So, and I think the banks have said they have not been agreed. So if the banks have nothing against
yeah, them, there's been no fraud. There is no fraud. It's not there.
It's not there. And it would fall on the banks, not on the borrower. Because they should be held, see, they're held liable by the feds, the FDIC, that they can't make loans on property that does not have to be measured up to that value. If the value is not there, they can't make a loan on it.
So Father, your word says, no weapon formed against Donald Trump shall prosper, and every word spoken in judgment against him, he shall condemn, and we stand with him, and we condemn that word because that is the heritage of the children of God. In Jesus' name.
Amen. With the wings to those words of his, of condemnation for this, and he has offered those up. So we just speak out that those words will fly forward and they will accomplish that for which they are destined to accomplish.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
So are they making this up to make people buy into it? Is that what I'm understanding?
And there's nothing legal about it. It should be thrown out. It's just a New York,
whatever.
Witch hunt.
This is a ploy against people who are wealthy and who they want to gin up resentment toward wealthy people.
It's a political stunt. Now, out of this, every conservative sold their business and left New York City. But Lord, can they go somewhere else besides Texas?